Forecasters say one of the most powerful cyclones we've ever seen is focusing its destructive energy on Cairns. Yasi, a Category 3, is deepening and gathering strength. By the time it crosses the coast, it's feared it will have grown to a high Category 4, worse than Cyclone Larry. And its arrival has been pinpointed to 1 on Thursday morning, flooding the centre of Cairns.
By tomorrow, authorities warn it'll be too late to run and far too dangerous to even try.
This storm is huge and it is life-threatening.
Roads out of Cairns are choked with people fleeing as the tourist city braces for a direct hit.
In reality, we would like people to get as far south as possible, quickly as possible.
With the monster storm due to hit in just over 24 hours, panic is setting in.
We don't want to be here when the cyclone comes.
Those who couldn't get out by road hit the airport, with airlines bringing in extra planes to cope with the demand.
So it's a bit scary. I'm a single mother with four children.
Homeowners in low-lying areas face mandatory evacuations tonight, with predictions they'll be swamped by a 2.5-metre storm surge, which will affect 9,000 people.
We're boarding everything up. We've screwed down all the storm shutters. I'm putting ply over all the windows.
The hospitals in Cairns are also being emptied.
There is a real risk that the hospital in Cairns will be inundated with water.
11 planes will ferry more than 250 patients out tonight to hospitals in Brisbane.
This is a very big exercise, but we're not sure that we've ever totally evacuated a big regional hospital like this in Queensland's history.
When it hits, Yasi will be a Category 4, larger and more powerful than Larry.
Very scary.
Residents who've decided to ride out the storm can expect to be without power for days, maybe even weeks.
You get sick of eating tin food after a few days, so it doesn't hurt to get a Jenny so you can run your fridge.
But if there's one thing they know in the tropics, that's cyclones are unpredictable, so the residents of Townsville aren't relaxing just yet.
Getting ready for the worst and praying for the best.
Lisa Rolls, 10 News.
Well, the Premier has just received the latest update and we're grateful for her time. Premier, what do we need to know?
Thank you. Yes, Georgie, the latest modelling from the Bureau indicates that there hasn't been any change. This is still a high Category 4 cyclone heading for the coast of Queensland, most likely to strike somewhere between Port Douglas and Innisfail. These are large population centres, and for all of those people who live in this area, I think they are now facing a very anxious 24 hours for what will be, this time tomorrow night, a very frightening event. People have been taking heed of the warnings, and I thank them for that. We will get through this as long as people keep cooperating with the authorities. Those people who are moving today, if they're in those low-lying areas, have done the right thing. We're putting more people in there today, paramedics, fire and rescue, to make sure that we are ready to help people through this event.
Well, yesterday you were telling us we had only today to evacuate. Is everyone who needs to be out of harm's way?
There will be continued evacuations throughout the evening and maybe in the early hours of tomorrow morning, but we do expect to see gale force winds by about somewhere between 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. tomorrow morning, and they will then just escalate throughout the day, and roads will be cut north of Townsville from about 8 o'clock tomorrow. Not all roads, but some, so you can't rely on roads being open, and airports likely to close tomorrow. Today was the day when people needed to do the things that most of them have done, but there will be evacuations overnight, including that very large evacuation of Cairns Base Hospital and Cairns Private Hospital down here to hospitals in Brisbane.
A final word then, Premier. Anything we haven't given you a chance to say?
Look, only that I think our thoughts are with all of our friends in far north Queensland tonight. The next 24 hours is going to be a very frightening time for them, but I'm very confident of their resilience, and I know that between their experience and the expertise and professionalism of the people on the ground, this is something that together we can overcome.
Our thanks, as always, for keeping us informed, Premier Anna Bligh. Well, Sarah Horsley is in Townsville, and Sarah, what are you seeing?
Well, I have to say it's been a beautiful day in Townsville, sunshine and blue skies, but the wind has just started to pick up a little bit here, but it's very much the calm before the storm. And if Yasi continues on its current predicted path, Townsville may well escape the worst of this storm. Certainly a 4-metre storm surge has already been revised down, but people here have been through cyclones. They know how unpredictable they are, and they are very well preparing for the worst. People in low-lying areas are on high alert. Townsville's expecting a lot of rain out of this system. The ground is already soaked, and let's not forget, Townsville is built on a floodplain.
And Sarah, have people taken that advice to simply get out?
Well, I've just gotten off the phone from one woman who's been packing up all day. She's in a particularly vulnerable area in the northern beaches of Townsville, and she's going to leave her home tonight. Nursing homes have already been evacuated, and tourists, they're leaving Townsville by the hordes, buses, planes and trains. As for locals, an evacuation centre hasn't been set up here yet, but there is a shelter that will be organised for people to ride out the storm. So very much nervous residents here in North Queensland as we brace for Yazzie.
Stay safe. Thanks, Sarah Horsley in Townsville. Dad Jamie Rule has been preparing his home on Magnetic Island. He joins us now via Skype. Jamie, what can you do to prepare yourself?
In our case, it's just a case of doing the simple things, but making sure you prepare and prepare early, making sure you've got enough water, tinned foods, batteries. Neighbour beside us has a boat, so he's made sure he's hitched his boat up to his four-wheel drive so that together they can't fly off anywhere. In our case, we've got a spa, an outdoor spa, so we've actually emptied that of the water, and we've put 500 litres of water back into that so that we can cope should we have the water go out on us here.
Well, it's you, your wife and your four-year-old son. What do you imagine you'll be doing at 1 a.m. on Thursday?
Hopefully we'll be fairly comfortable with our cyclones. Strategy in our house is, we've got a couple of mattresses that if it all goes a bit pear-shaped, we retreat to our second bathroom, which is in the centre of the house. It's a smallish bathroom and it's well self-contained with only a small window. So that's our plan of attack should we lose a section of the roof or start losing windows.
Well, please do stay safe. Thanks, Jamie Rule on Magnetic Island.
No worries.
Now to the Weather Channel and Lee Brooks. Lee, can you give the people in Yasi's path a clear idea of the strength of this cyclone?
Look, Yazzie, at the moment, Georgie, is intensifying very rapidly and is expected to make landfall as a Category 4 system. Now, this is packing wind speeds of between 220 and 280 kilometres an hour. That's strong enough to shred trees, rip out power lines. It could potentially lift caravans and toss them away. It will cause roof and structural damage and damage to boats, bridges and roads as well. And we can't forget the storm surge either. We could be seeing the water level lifted to between 2 and 5 metres above the normal high tide mark. And this is what, to put it in perspective, caused much of the damage in Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans. New Orleans is very low-lying and most of the devastation was caused by the storm surge.
Historically for Queensland, is there anything to compare this with?
Historically, look, Larry and also Cyclone Tracy in Darwin both crossed as Category 4 systems, but we've got to remember that Cyclone Yasi is about twice the size of Larry, so we're expecting to see the winds and the heavy rainfall extending a few hundred kilometres out from the eye of the storm, so potentially much worse impact could be felt.
Okay, thanks for your time. Lee Brooks from the Weather Channel.
Thanks, Georgie.
It is now 30 hours and 20 minutes from the moment Yasi bares its teeth, and based on the latest information we've just heard from the Premier, that will happen over Cairns. Anthony Donaghy is there, and Anthony, what's it like in the city as you travel around at the moment?
Well, as we go to air, Georgie, the two main hospitals in Cairns are being evacuated. There'll be a convoy of ambulances taking those patients to the airport, where around 11 aircraft will fly them to Brisbane, including an Army Hercules. But as you walk around the town here, there's still backpackers and holiday makers. Now, whether or not they leave tomorrow or the next day is still unclear, but we are expecting winds of around 130 kilometres tomorrow, and that's still a good 10 hours before Cyclone Yasi hits. Even at those winds, it'll be very hard to stand in the street.
Well, Anthony, you were in Innisfail earlier today. They probably know better than anyone else what's in store.
Oh, they certainly do, Georgie. The people of Innisfail still have Cyclone Larry etched in their minds. That cyclone hit in March 2006 and flattened that town and took out one of Australia's largest banana growing regions. Now, this cyclone has inched a little bit south, so if it continues to curl around, it could go through Innisfail again, and it'll be hard to imagine how that town would have to rebuild for a second time.
Like we say, 30 hours and 20 minutes. Thanks, Anthony Donaghy in Cairns. It's not just people. Huge coal ships delayed by floods are trying to outrun cyclonic seas. Jonathan Lee has been over them.
Well, from floods to cyclones, everybody here in Gladstone is on edge. The port itself is still only operating at around 50% capacity following the recent floods. There's around 20 ships still moored off the coast here in Gladstone. They're waiting to see exactly what's going to transpire with their cyclone. Further up the coast in Cairns, Townsville and Mackay, ships there have been forced to move to open waters or further south as they try to escape the devastation. The shipping lanes themselves are closed, the ports are closed. People just aren't quite sure yet what they're going to do. Here, people are waiting to see what transpires. They don't know if they're going to end up having to make a dash further out to sea or back down towards Brisbane to get to the safer areas. The industry itself is also concerned. Cyclone warnings are being put in place and management is currently taking places exactly what they're going to do. They're battening down the hatches. They're trying to make sure that the power station itself is managed. That's one of the key factors here, making sure that they don't lose power. This area is driving the local and the state's economy. They want to make sure that not only do they get back up to speed as quickly as possible, but they're running at full capacity as soon as possible.